Great. So CETA is a network of scientists and engineers at the university who design programs and services for people in developing countries. And we like to think of ourselves as the analytics team in any major tech company, except that we're focused on public policy and poverty alleviation. And I want to say a few things about the problem that we're trying to solve, which is that too few of the programs that development agencies deliver are actually based on evidence. At the top of this slide, you see a quote from the Center for Global Development in DC, some of our colleagues, who point out that about $50 million are invested annually in rigorous research and evaluation of development programs, relative to $150 billion invested annually, or 130 in official development assistance. So that's about 0.5%. And just for comparison's sake, Google spends about 18% of its expenses on research and development. That was in 2014. Intel is spending about a quarter of its expenses on R&D. And so no private sector company would spend 0.5% on R&D to develop its products. And so we're trying to introduce more analytics and research into the development sector. There is an exception, and that's Mexico. This photo is from the Progresa program in Mexico. In the late 1990s, the Mexican government decided to incorporate rigorous randomized experiments, A-B testing, into the design of their biggest social welfare program called Progresa. And one of the CETA researchers, Paul Gertler, who's not here today, he was one of the first to work with the government on a randomized trial. They were adding innovative incentives into a cash transfer or welfare program to make it more cost effectiveness. The outcomes were really compelling, and this approach has now been adopted by 30 countries on every continent in the world. What you're going to hear about today, which is really exciting, is the extension of this pretty seminal work by GiveDirectly and Paul Niehaus, and the introduction of new technologies to make these programs even more effective. So the Center for Effective Global Action, our model is to really diagnose challenges or threats in global development, design solutions, do a lot of A-B testing in the field, and then work with governments and NGOs to scale up the products. What we're trying to do is create very durable solutions for development. And we invest in portfolios of projects that allow us to make apples-to-apples comparisons between different anti-poverty approaches. So to improve poor farmers' incomes, should governments subsidize fertilizer, or should they give flexible credit products that are timed to the harvest cycles? Those are the kinds of questions that we're trying to answer. We have a number of portfolios of research, each with about 10 to 20 experiments or products being developed. We think that the portfolio approach is important for a couple of reasons. One is that it allows us to build visibility in the sector. It almost serves as a kind of branding and allows us to get buy-in from development practitioners. It also lets us hedge the risk that any one experiment will fail. So it's a useful approach, and this is how we kind of operate. I'm going to give you a couple of examples from our portfolio, things that have gone on to scale, which is pretty exciting for us. Our Evidence to Action event last year focused on agricultural development, and at that event we shared some of the big wins in the ag sector, including a credit product for small-scale farmers that generated about $20 in additional profit per farmer per year. That was a project done in partnership with One Acre Fund, where we randomized the rollout. The researchers for that project are here today, and you'll hear from them later. We also last year highlighted a subsidy for flood-tolerant rice. The researchers in this project are here as well. That produced 45% gains in yields for the farmers who adopted it, with gains even in non-flood years, because farmers started investing in fertilizer once their climate risks were taken care of. So these are the kinds of insights we get from analytics, and we are hoping to expand this approach globally. So a couple more examples from our portfolio in education. Karthik Murlidharan is here. You'll hear him talk later today about bioauthentication and its use in poverty programs in India, how it introduces efficiencies. But he's probably best known for his work introducing performance-based pay for teachers in India. And that was a massive randomized trial in Andhra Pradesh showing improvements in children's learning as a result of teacher pay reforms. Pay reform significantly outperformed investments in books and school supplies. And now, as evidence of further scaling, he's working with the Tanzanian government to push this approach into a new country. We're also going to hear, as I mentioned, from Paul Niehaus and GiveDirectly. Raise your hand if you've heard of GiveDirectly. Wow, Wow, pretty much everyone in the room. That's fantastic. So as I mentioned, Give Directly extends the work on cash transfers in Mexico and subsequent research elsewhere, and adapts the approach for very low-income countries, and allows the private sector and NGOs to participate in cash transfers. So he's going to tell us about his work, which is at the intersection of e-payments and mobile computing and behavioral economics. One of the best known examples of research in poverty alleviation comes from Ted Miguel and colleagues' work in Kenya. With an initial investment of about $1 million in research over multiple years, Ted and his colleagues showed that deworming children through schools improves school attendance more cost effectively than school uniforms or textbooks or other interventions. So as a result of this evidence, more than 100 million children are being treated each year throughout Kenya and India. And the scale-up continues through a wonderful NGO called Evidence Action based in DC. So this is just the example of how evidence really does translate into action over time. And today, Ted is going to talk about something totally different. It's the behavioral design of a water technology. But it's a story with another positive ending, which is that USAID now is scaling up that technology in East Africa. So I want to leave you with three key messages about SIGA to frame the day. The first is that we're really trying to be at the forefront of a push toward development analytics. We're using remote sensing, we use A/B testing in the field, a lot of other scientific methods to measure program effectiveness. We're looking for the products and services with the biggest return on investment so that donors and investments make better decisions about how to alleviate poverty. We are also trying to leverage the innovations developed here in Silicon Valley to develop analytics, to advance development analytics as a field. So we're working with microsatellite companies like Skybox, they're here today, to analyze crop yields in Kenya. We're working with big data and crowdsourced platforms like Premise, they're here as well today, to capture real-time prices of foods in informal markets. We then help the World Bank and other multilaterals and governments learn how to use the data that are generated by new technologies. And we're benchmarking the kinds of data that come out of new technologies against traditional methods for decision-making, like household surveys, polls, focus groups. Third message, finally, being at a university, we have the liberty to open source everything that we do. This means learning about failed interventions and publicizing or spreading the word about our failures. This helps us prevent money from being squandered on well-meaning but ineffective programs. So finally, we, as I mentioned, have seen large-scale adoption of some of the solutions developed by SIGA researchers, including by National Power Company of Kenya. We have a representative here from the Kenyan Rural Electrification Authority, from the government of Bihar, the NGO BRAC. There are a lot of examples of big scale-ups that result from research. And we're excited about proving ideas because then they can be adopted by other governments, by NGOs and firms. And it really multiplies the impact of the investment in research. So today we are sharing our technology portfolio with you, some examples of technologies that were designed for release into very complex settings. This is where people may be too poor to afford investment in a technology, or where markets are just too distorted for the private sector to thrive. We're trying to build some durable lessons about how to design pro-poor products for developing countries, and we're excited to share what we've learned. Referencing Hal's point, we really hope to learn from your experience as well. There are a lot of engineers and development practitioners and economists in the room, and we hope to connect with you during the breaks. So thank you again for joining us. I'd now like to introduce Anne-Meg Cheng, our keynote speaker. She's a Stanford grad and not a stranger to the Bay Area at all. She was the senior engineering director at Google for several years, where she led engineering for mobile apps and services. Then she moved to Mercy Corps, an international development NGO, where she was chief innovation officer. And now she's executive director of the US Global Development Lab at USAID. It's the agency's newest bureau. We're very excited to see the pivot at USAID toward science and technology. The Global Development Lab actually funds most of our technology portfolio, including many of the examples you'll see here today. And that's through a program we call the Development Impact Lab. And as I mentioned, USAID is also helping to scale some of the innovations that you'll learn about today. So it's really exciting to see these kinds of linkages between USAID, Silicon Valley, the network of researchers in SIGA. So I will just thank you all for joining, and please welcome Anne Chang.